Following this service, the family invites you to join them at the Mount Pleasant Cemetery just outside of Houghton for a brief committal service, including bagpipes and military rites. The committal will begin by at least 3:30 today. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you also shall live." We have gathered here today to praise God and to witness our faith as we celebrate the life of Gus Prinsell. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. During this time, may God search each of our hearts, that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, in death, resurrection. O God of life, as we have learned to do in all of our experiences, we come to you now in the hour of death. We know that you love us, and we know that you can turn even the shadow of death into the light of morning. Help us now to wait before you with reverent and submissive hearts. Make this a time of opening our eyes and our understanding, and a time of encouragement to each one of our hearts and souls. Help us to see you and to know your wondrous love to us in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Please stand for the first hymn.
Thank you. My father touched so many lives in different ways. Most of you know him as Dr. Prinsell, who truly cared about his patients. I remember tagging along as a sixth grader on weekends when he would make house calls, which meant driving all over the county to treat patients who were too disabled or sick to travel to his office. In addition to his medical office in Houghton, he also worked at the local hospitals and served as a school physician at both Houghton College and Fillmore. Before this, he served as a medical missionary in Sierra Leone, West Africa for 7 years, where he treated all kinds of tropical infectious diseases from malaria to leprosy. He also operated to save lives with C-sections and trauma surgery. I remember the time my dad grabbed these raw cashew nuts that my brother Joel and I were going to cook because they release a deadly cyanide-like chemical called urushiol. Now, who knows that, right? He was an astute diagnostician, often making the medical diagnosis with just a scant sign or a symptom. His hunches were rarely wrong. Again, as a sixth grader, I remember breaking my arm. It was a displaced fracture, which means it was sticking straight up just like this. So he brought me over to his office. He said, grab my hand. I'll grab yours with my right hand. He pulled here, and with his left hand, he pulled here, and these bones went sliding back in. I'm screaming. And then the nurse put plaster of Paris on while it set up. Anyway, no x-rays, no CT scan, and the arm still works great. All right. And I'm sure many of you have stories to tell how he helped you as your doctor as well. I'll never forget his words of wisdom. Everyone deserves medical care, even though they might not be able to afford it. Treating patients is not a right, it's a privilege. Treat your patients as you would your own family. And finally, as a Christian doctor, the healing of physical infirmities is a testimony of God's mercy, love, and power. My dad had a very sharp mind, not just in the sciences, in medicine, but also love of history and other subjects. He always won our family games of Trivial Pursuit. He was always a student and studying to learn. He took notes during sermons at church. I don't know if you knew that, Pastor West. And even in his 90s, he studied his medical journals to keep current, and he actually audited courses at Houghton College, often scoring the highest test scores on exams. At the age of 94, he wrote a book, The Papa Bear, his memoir. And up until the very end of his life, his mind remained very sharp. My father was also a World War II vet. He proudly served his country, and he enjoyed marching down Main Street Memorial Day Parade every year in Fillmore and the camaraderie of his fellow vets. He loved being a member of this community. My dad was also a devout Christian. When the Lord called him to be a medical missionary, he acted on faith. On his medical school interview at Columbia University, an Ivy League school, he was mocked by some for wanting to become a missionary doctor in Africa. Little did he realize that he had been interviewed by the only faculty member who had been a medical missionary, and that each interviewer was granted only one automatic acceptance by the admission committee. My dad received his acceptance letters within 2 weeks, which, quite frankly, is unheard of. Then, when the time came for him to actually go to Sierra Leone and become a medical missionary, on only a $4,000 a year salary, he turned down a very lucrative group practice offer in Saginaw, Michigan. The senior doctor said, Gus, you're making a big mistake. You're throwing it all away. Think of your family, your kids. How will you provide for them? They will never receive a good education. My dad replied, the Lord will provide. My dad loved reading the Bible and praying and singing. Even though he couldn't carry a tune, he never hesitated in making a joyful noise in church. My brothers and I will always remember having to attend church services every Sunday, morning and evening, midweek prayer meetings, Bible studies, and family devotions. To the very end of his life, his faith never wavered. Even last year, he would kneel down on his knees at his bedside every morning to pray for each of us, his 4 sons, our wives, 7 grandkids, 5 great-grandchildren, all by name. 6 years ago, his first great-grandson, still in his mother's womb, developed a rare, life-threatening condition in which lymphatic fluid was filling up his tiny lungs. None of the best cardiothoracic surgeons in the world, none of the most modern tiny sutures could stitch together that leaking, papier-mâché, thin, tiny thoracic duct in his chest. They said, all you can do now is pray for a miracle. My dad called some of you here to reunite a prayer chain with anointing of oil. Miraculously, it heals spontaneously. Still, no doctor or specialist around the world can explain it. What no earthly surgeon could stitch together, God could. For it says in Psalms 139:13, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. 4 years ago, that same great-grandson traveled up from Atlanta with his parents to be baptized here by Pastor Wes here in this church. Last year, during a sleepover at our house, he asked, I want to become a Christian. Can you pray with me? Choking back my tears, I did, and he started jumping up and down in the bed saying, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian. Now that is the Christian fruit of a medical miracle by the grace of a loving and merciful God who answered prayers initiated by the strong Christian faith of his great-grandfather. May I hear an amen? Thank you. My dad was also a devoted husband. He adored Louise. He was so in awe that he once poured hot coffee all over a restaurant table when gazing into her eyes. This past summer, my parents celebrated their 75th wedding anniversary. When her health started to fail a few years back, my dad never left her side, trying to care for her until he was no longer physically able. He made sure that all her health care and other needs would be taken care of down to the last detail if he were to pass first. Jan Schilke, Carol Stometz, Kelly Smith, and others, I'm remiss in mentioning, you are truly angels. My brothers and I cannot thank you enough for the wonderful love and care you provided for my parents over these past years. You're like family. And like many of your godly fathers of that same older generation, some of whom I have had the wonderful privilege of knowing, my father also was there for my brothers and me, providing for our needs, disciplining our wrongs, sharing our concerns, encouraging our efforts, celebrating our achievements, laughing with our joys, comforting our sorrows, offering sage advice, and loving us unconditionally. By example, they demonstrated and taught us values, values such as sacrifice, hard work, patience, perseverance, education, family, love, and Christian principles. My dad grew up very poor during the Great Depression, but had loving Christian parents who he respected and honored. He had to work after school as a young teen to help support them and his three younger siblings. He was a loving Christian father to my brothers and me as well. Even when disciplining us as kids, he would pray together, though my prayers were just simply that the spanking wouldn't hurt too much. He always made time to attend our sports, music, and other activities at Fillmore and Houghton College. As adults, we continued to seek his advice. Even this past year, when faced with decisions, my wife Kim would say, call your dad. He'll know what to do. And you know what? His advice was always spot on. I once asked, half jokingly, Dad, should our 10% tithe be on before or after tax dollars? He replied, well, that depends on how rich you want God's blessings to be. My dad lived a very full life, 100 years old. I once asked him, Dad, what's the secret to living a long life? Healthy food, regular exercise, yearly checkups. He said, with that slight grin of his, yes, all that is important, but always remember the fifth commandment. And I'm thinking, thou shalt not. He goes, no. Honor thy father and thy mother so that you will live a long life. Throughout his long life, my dad always taught us the importance of strong family, and children. He loved children. The following verses mean so much to me as a son, father, and now a grandfather. Psalm 127:3, behold, our children are a heritage from the Lord. Deuteronomy 7:9. Therefore, know that the Lord your God, faithful God, who keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations with those who love and keep his commandments. Psalm 103:17. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children. Proverbs 17:6. Children's children are the crown of old men, and the glory of the children is their father. Just 2 months ago, at his 100th birthday celebration, my father was telling us stories of Africa and his walk with the Lord. His great-grandchildren from Georgia, whom he rarely sees, only 4 to 6 years old, listened intently and asked questions. And now they ask me, their grandfather, about him, Africa, and Christ. Imagine that, a 100-year-old saint, his frail body near death, still ministering about the love of Christ, especially to a 4-year-old. As Jesus said, let the children come to me, for to such belongs the kingdom of heaven. In closing, as we remember my father's exemplary, well-lived, full life, our griefs are lessened, our sorrows comforted, knowing that he now rejoices in loving arms of Jesus. Dad always said he was richly blessed, not with worldly wealth or possessions, but with God's blessings that are twofold. First, by the grace of God on earth, and secondly, as an eternal reward in heaven. When you think about it, an eternal heavenly salvation that conquers our earthly death. What a wonderful promise now fulfilled for my father. And to us, what a blessed assurance. Fathers like this are like diamonds, precious and rare, and such precious memories are treasures. Dad, I miss you very much and will always love you.
Oh, Well, today is a day of celebration, not mourning. 100 great years lived, and thank you all for joining us to remember my father's life. He was a husband to my mother, who is in her usual seat, by the way. She owns that seat back in that corner and has for decades. A father to four of us who are here, a grandfather, a great-grandfather, and a great-grandfather-to-be very soon, Alicia, thank you. And he had a tear in his eye when she called him about a month ago and said, there's another one on the way, which was good. He was a friend to so many of you here. He was a doctor to so many of you here, and both to a few. And to all the angels who have taken care of my mother and father and mother in the last few years, thank you so much. Many of them are here today. And he was an uncle, and three of his nephews are here today. And he was an aunt, and he's as a great aunt, two of his great nieces are here today, and we thank them for coming as well. Now, 8 years ago, my dad called me one night, because he was always determined and always had things going on, and he said, I need to type my memoirs. I said, oh, okay, are you serious about that? He said, oh, yes. I said, well, and then he sat down on his old Royal typewriter. We're not talking about laptops and Word documents or any of that, just an old typewriter. And I got, about 6 months later, I got 250 pages typewritten with whiteout fluid, marks through it, little letters corrected, and it turned 3 years later into the Papa Bear. He asked me to be his editor, and I accepted, and he asked me to write the introduction, which I did. So no one is allowed to plagiarize, but I'm going to plagiarize myself. I chose to write about what greatness was, meaning, of course, in the end, talking about my father. And it is not about wealth or fame or power or position. It is about beliefs and convictions and values and dedication and service. As Albert Schweitzer, a missionary who preceded my father by decades, said, the only ones among you who will be truly happy are those who serve. And his life was absolutely a life of service. Number one, he served God above and beyond everything else on the mission field here in northern Allegheny County, Houghton College, establishing the Gustave and Louise Prinsell Scholarship Fund, which has been in existence for 30 years and has helped a student every year whose life is dedicated to medical missions. And up until recently, they chose that candidate and interviewed them every single year. And of course, the Houghton Wesleyan Church, where we are today, and of course, all the other branches starting way back when he was very young in Jersey City. He also served his family and has produced generations with values of grandchildren and great-grandchildren, and of course, his sons, and our wives, and our spouses. He served his country. As Jeff mentioned, World War II on a minesweeper, both the Atlantic and Pacific regions of war, with Japanese submarines chasing him around, German submarines chasing him around. He served his country and served it well, and that's gonna be recognized later today. He served his community. And you all know that so well. Whether the community was in Kamakwi, whether the community was northern Allegheny County, wherever he went, he served his community. And finally, he served the whole world, especially Africa and America. He gave his life to others in service. So with all his humility and selflessness, my father was a great man. He is now in heaven.
Let us pray. With the psalmist of old, we praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. We praise you, God, for revealing yourself to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who came as a servant, reached out to the poor, healed the sick, loved the lowly, and gave his life to open the gates of heaven and the path of abundant life to all who turn to him. And today we acknowledge your gift and the life of Gus Prinsell. He received your transforming grace. He loved, devoured, and shared your powerful word. And he served others so graciously in the same spirit as Jesus. Lord, we know so much about your heart, your character, and your purposes because we have seen the life of this prince who knew you and walked amongst us. May his compassion and witness continue to bear fruit for generations around the world, in his beloved Sierra Leone, here close to home, and especially in our own hearts. Lord, bless and comfort his dear wife, our friend Louise, and the entire family. And may they remember the precious love and godly impact that your servant uniquely lavished on them. Help the rest of us to remain faithful in prayer and kindness to this family. Teach us to so number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom, and likewise shine the light of Jesus all our days. With confidence, we cling to the promises that you gave to your prophets of old, to the trustworthy words of Jesus and your apostles. We know that the best is yet to come. We give you praise in the name of Jesus. Amen. A little bigger print here, but I'm reading from Daniel chapter 12 at the request of Gus. Is that correct? And one of the last times we did scripture together, he said, read chapter 12, verse 13. So it's here. Listen for it. At that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. There will be a time of distress such as had not happened from the beginning of the nations until then. But at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in the book, will be delivered. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. But you, Daniel, roll up and seal the words of the scroll until the time of the end. Many will go here and there to increase knowledge. Then I, Daniel, looked, and there before me stood two others, one on this bank of the river and one on the opposite bank. One of them said to the man clothed in linen, who was above the waters of the river, "How long will it be before these astonishing things are fulfilled?" The man clothed in linen, who was above the waters of the river, lifted his right hand and his left hand toward heaven. And I heard him swear by him who lives forever, saying, "It will be for a time, times and a half a time. When the power of the holy people has been finally broken, all these things will be completed." I heard, but I did not understand. So I asked my Lord, "What will the outcome of all this be?" He replied, "Go your way, Daniel, because the words are rolled up and sealed until the time of the end. Many will be purified, made spotless and refined, but the wicked will continue to be wicked. None of the wicked will understand, but those who are wise will understand. From the time that the daily sacrifice is abolished and the abomination that causes desolation is set up, there will be 1,290 days. Blessed is the one who waits for and reaches the end of the 1,335 days. As for you, go your way till the end. You will rest And then at the end of the days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance. This is the word of the Lord.
This is a day of mixed and varied emotions. On one hand, we grieve because one we have loved is no longer with us, and it's difficult to think of life without Gus. We come today to affirm that our lives were affected and continue to be affected by our relationship with him, and we grieve that things are different. At the same time, we celebrate today because Gus, for whom the past few months in particular were so difficult, is now free from his suffering. He's resting in Jesus. And we're here this afternoon because we believe that what we've read in Scripture today and what we've sung about Scripture today is true. All the promises of God are true. This life is not the end, and as painful and real as death is, we're here today to declare that we are people who live and breathe and trust the hope that is ours in the risen Christ. A few weeks ago, as happened with Paul, I was sitting by Gus's bedside, and he mentioned to me that when this day came, he wanted me to talk about the book of Daniel, and specifically the last verse of Daniel. Now, I have to tell you, I love the book of Daniel, but it's a complicated book. And particularly the last part of it. And I wonder myself, how in the world am I going to do that? Talk about the end of Daniel at a funeral service. But I've come to see why Gus made that request. Daniel's a book that's written to people at a time when they feel overwhelmed in their attempt to live for God in a world that is against God. In one sense, that's true of all times, but it was especially true at that time. And so the first six chapters, we have stories like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, and we have Daniel in the lion's den. And the stories are a reminder to God's people that despite what it looks like, he is still God, and they can trust him. But the second chapters of Daniel are not stories about what God has done, but visions about what God is promising to do. And like most prophecy, they are ripe with symbolism and uncertainty, and quite frankly, are often difficult to understand and interpret. In fact, in chapter 12, as Paul just read, Daniel writes, "I heard, but I didn't understand." And we struggle to understand too. And yet the truth revealed in the earlier stories of Daniel doesn't change in the latter part. It's the same truth. God is the only God. He alone is almighty, and despite the power of evil that seems insurmountable, he is not just greater, he is infinitely greater. His power is unmatched greatness, and we can trust him. And Daniel's point is this: if we can trust him in the present, we can trust him in the future, the immediate future and the eternal future. And so the entire book ends with these words: "As for you, go your way till the end. You will rest, and then at the end of the days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance." And you can see then why Gus wanted us to think about that verse today. It was a promise that resonated with him, and it resonated with him as he reflected on the faithfulness of God through his entire life. It resonated with him as he was facing the reality of death. It resonated with him as he pondered life after death. And in every moment of reflection, the point, the purpose was clear. This is a declaration and a promise of who God is. And it's in this knowledge of who God is that makes all the difference for Gus, for you, for me. The only reason today is not a time that completely devastates us is because of who God is. In fact, because of who God is, we can actually gather today to celebrate even in our grief. Because of who God is, we can experience joy even in our sorrow. Because of who God is, we can know without any doubt that Gus has joined his family and God's people through the ages, resting in the arms of Jesus. Of course, being a follower of Jesus isn't primarily about life after death, as important and vital as that promise of eternal life is. Being a follower of Jesus is about the grace and power of God in our lives even now. We don't have to wait for eternity to experience the faithfulness of God. We don't have to wait for eternity to experience the grace and love, the redemption and transformation of God. The great promise of Scripture is that life can be full and blessed and transformed. We can be righteous people even now. A few years ago, Gus talked to me about his funeral service, and another verse that, or series of verses that he mentioned to me was Titus 2, verses 11 to 14. He found great joy and hope in Paul's words, "For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for that blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good." And what's fascinating about those stories in Daniel are not just about God's people doing what is right against frightening opposition. They're also about doing what's right as a means of influencing the very people who oppose them. One of the most fascinating things about the God Scripture reveals is that even though he is the Almighty God, he rejoices to include his people in the joy and privilege of accomplishing his purposes in the world. Daniel 12:3 speaks of God's servants shining like the brightness of the sky in order to lead many to righteousness. The Apostle Paul picks up on that same theme when he encourages the Philippians to be children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation, and then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life. Gus was devoted to God and to shining his light. I had many conversations with him about his burden for college students. Until they couldn't do it anymore, Gus and Louise faithfully attended chapel every time they had it. They faithfully attended Koinonia and celebrated this college student-led worship time on Sunday nights. He spoke often of his burden for people in Allegheny County, the spiritual needs as well as the socioeconomic needs. And we're all aware of his passion and commitment to the needs of people all over the world, medical needs and spiritual needs. And all of this was not to bring glory and attention to him, but to Jesus. And ultimately, that's why we're here today. For as much as we celebrate Gus's life, as much as we appreciate his influence and admire his faithfulness to God, today is ultimately about God's faithfulness to him and to us. It's God's faithfulness that gives us hope in our struggle, that gives life even in death, that leads us to worship him and to glorify him and to follow him. It's God's faithfulness that we celebrate and for which we give thanks in every moment, including this moment. For we know that the Almighty God is good and gracious and merciful to Gus and to all of us. For Gus's life was all the things that we've heard today and all the things that we heard last night because of Christ, who redeemed him and changed him and transformed him and made him new through his wondrous grace. And he offers all of that to all of us every day. There are a couple of what I think are intriguing ironies in ending today with the gospel song, "How Great Thou Art." The hymn was originally composed by a Swedish pastor in the 1880s. And what I found interesting is that the first translation of the hymn from Swedish into English was in 1925 by a man whose first name was, interestingly enough, Gustav. Gustav Johnson. I found that name connection fascinating. In addition, the hymn was translated into a variety of languages, including Russian. And the Russian version was heard by Stuart Kine, who was unaware that it had already been translated into English, took the Russian version and translated it into English himself. And it's his version that we are most familiar with. The popularity in America of this song is directly tied to the fact that it became a staple in the Billy Graham Crusades. And its most popular solo version was sung by George Beverly Shea. And if you read Gus's book, you know that there is a long connection between the Shea family and the Prinsell family. Adam Shea, Paul's grandfather, was the pastor of the Wesley Methodist Church in Jersey City, and Pastor and Mrs. Shea were a great help to Gus's parents in some difficult times. And as Gus mentions in the book, for 2 years, while he was in high school, George Beverly Shea was a Sunday school teacher. So it seems kind of appropriate that we conclude with this song today. But it's not primarily because of these intriguing family connections, but because it's a song that draws our attention fully and completely to God. His greatness, his faithfulness, his creative wonder, his glorious love, and his unmatched grace. My prayer is that as we sing, we will be reminded of God's greatness to Gus, to us, to everyone, now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
Receive the benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.